Good morning. Welcome to Calvary Bible Church, and if you can make your way to a seat, and we'll be able to get our service started this morning. As you just saw, a little promo video for our series that we'll be starting. Actually, we'll have a reading service next week and then begin preaching through the book of 1 Corinthians starting on August 18th. So if you are inclined to do so, you may take an opportunity to read through the book of 1 Corinthians and get yourself and your mind ready for that. I want to welcome each and every one of you to Calvary Bible Church, and we trust that today's service will be a blessing to one and all. We're a little short-handed this morning because we have a lot of our folks down in Haiti, and just want to let you know that they did arrive safely, and we want you to be in prayer for them, but we're thankful to have you here, and we want to let you know that during our service, later on, right before the message, we will be dismissing the children ages 4 all the way up through 4th grade to go to junior church. And we're excited to have that opportunity for them. And they'll be more than welcome to join in and participate in that service that's specifically designed for them. And so we would encourage you parents to allow them to go when they're dismissed. And there'll be somebody there to escort them and make sure that they get to their place safe and sound. And so we look forward to them being able to enjoy that while we spend some time in the Word together. And Pastor Chris will be speaking for us today. After church, in between church and our Sunday school, back through these doors and to your left is our hospitality room. And in the hospitality room, you'll find some coffee and warm beverages and some snack items, and be a great time for you to get to know people. If you're visiting, we welcome you to come back there. We'd also welcome you to come by our welcome table over here in the corner here, and we have a gift for you if this is your first time. And it'll be an opportunity for you to find out about the various ministries of Calvary Bible Church, perhaps find out about our Sunday schools and how you might be able to get involved in those as well. So please take advantage of that. If you are visiting or if you're a regular attender, we have a connecting card on the inside of our bulletins that we would like you to use. And if you're visiting, just fill that out and give us your information so that we can be in communication with you in the week that comes here. And if you want to, you can drop it by the welcome table when you pick up your gift, or you can just drop it in the offering plate when it's passed, and that way we'll have a record of your visit and take advantage of getting to know you a little bit better. Also, if you're a regular tender, there's all different kinds of ministry opportunities, and we would welcome you to sign up for those or any other needs that you might have. In particular, I want to highlight the other category on that connecting card where you can write in your prayer request. And on Wednesday nights, we have a group of people that gather together for a prayer meeting, Bible study and prayer, and they will pray through your request. So please take advantage of that. And we have a couple of items of service that you can get involved in. It's quickly becoming the fall months, and so it's hard to believe, but summer's almost over. And with that comes the fall programs, and we have a real need in the Awana. So if you are interested in being involved in the Awana, there's information in your bulletin, and you can serve our children well during that program. It runs throughout the school year. And then we also have ongoing needs in the nursery. And so if you are interested in helping out with that, that information is also in the bulletin, and you can use the connecting card to communicate with us, or you can contact the people directly that are in the bulletin. We would appreciate that. I want to remind you one more time of our group that's in Haiti and the names and the individuals. We have 28 of our people that are there, and as I said earlier, they arrive safe and sound. And we're excited about it. As we are gathered here, they'll be gathering in the church there in Jacmel, and they'll be worshiping in a French-speaking service. I'm sure they'll have some part in it, but just be in prayer for them as they get ready for a very busy week ahead. Travel went fine, everything went fine, and so we're just excited about that. And we would encourage you to use the names that you have here in your bulletin and pray for these folks daily, and that way you can be involved in their ministry that is there. There are a lot of other announcements that are in the bulletin. We would encourage you to take some time throughout the day to read the bulletin, to be aware of those ministry opportunities and the various things that are going on here at Calvary Bible Church, and to be in prayer for them. And so the bulletin can become a very handy tool for you. And again, we thank you for being here, and let's just bow in a word of prayer and ask God's blessing on our time together. Our Father, we are thankful for the privilege that we have to gather in your presence. We've been talking for the last several weeks about the holiness of God and how that is to be lived out in our lives. And so we want to pause at this moment and to recognize your holy presence here with us. And because of your holy presence, we have a responsibility in the way that we sing, the way that we engage in the words, and the way that we give, and the way that we study your word. We have a responsibility to recognize your presence and to worship you as you deserve. And so we pause now, and there might be many things that are going on in our hearts and lives at this moment. All of those become secondary to the fact that you are here. You are here to be worshiped and praised and adored. And I pray that as a church body, as we gather, that we will be encouraged through the songs, through the word, to lift our hearts in praise that brings honor and glory to your name. You are our audience this morning. We do not sing to the stage or to our neighbors, but we sing our songs of praise to you. You deserve far more, but we thank you for the privilege that we have to worship you today. Now bless and guide us in our time. Strengthen and encourage us. Be glorified in our midst, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand together as we sing. And I don't know about you, but the series on holiness has been fantastic, I think, and real challenge and a real blessing. And this morning, we're going to kind of just look back to, through song, the really the foundation of it is that God has separated us, made us holy, as we've heard, through the cross of Jesus Christ. So just think about the cross. We're going to be taking communion here together in a little while as well. So we'll prepare us for that. So let's just think about Jesus, who he is, and all that he's done, and worship him. Can I get my guitar on, too? Not hearing any guitar. I'm not sure if it's on out there. Just grab that.
Giver of every breath that you breathe, author of all eternity, giver of every perfect being, to you be the glory. Maker of heaven and earth, no one can comprehend your word. King over all the universe, to you be the glory. And I'm alive. It's all because of Jesus I'm alive. And it's all because of the blood of Jesus Christ. It covers me and raises different life. It's all because of Jesus I'm alive. Again, to the one who gives us life, my Savior, giver of every breath I breathe, author of all eternity, giver of every perfect thing, to you be the glory. Maker of heaven and over, no one can comprehend your word. King over all the universe, to you be the glory. Alive. governs me, raises dead men's lives. And it's all because of Jesus. Every sunrise sings your praise. The universe cries out your praise. Singing freedom all my days, now that I'm alive. It's all because of Jesus I am alive. It's all because of the blood of Jesus Christ. It covers me and raises death. Jesus, and it's all because of Jesus I am alive. And it's all because of the blood of Jesus Christ. It covers me, raises dead men's life. And it's all because of Jesus I am alive.
Cross where the giver of life gave his life for us.
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my riches on my pride. See from his head, his hands, his feet, star all in love, flow. Such love and sorrow me, all thorns compose, so rich of now. Oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the wonderful cross, bids me come. And find that I may truly live. Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross. All who gather here by grace shall live and bless your name. My salvation in. Bless your name. Sing again, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross. Bids me come and die and find that I may truly live. Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the drawn in and bless your name. And love so amazing, so divine, deep as my soul, my life, my. Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. The heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. And this is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. Perfect submission, perfect delight. Visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, bring from above. Echoes of mercy, whispers of love. And this is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior.
Pastor Chris is going to be talking to us about holiness as it relates to eternity this morning, and we look forward to that. And in that last song, we said, blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. And I love that phrase. And then later on it says, watching and waiting, looking above. And just a great song to remind us of the security that we have in Jesus, not only for now, but for our future, and the abundant life that we have in Him. And when we think about eternity, we realize that all that really matters in the end is, do we know Jesus? Because that's where we're going, is to be with Jesus. So we'll just sing this song, recognizing the sufficiency of Christ. I'm looking forward to that day when we'll begin eternity with Him.
I once was lost in darkest night, yet thought I knew the way. The sin that promised joy and life and led me to the grave. I had no hope that You would own or ever to.
The ushers for and come forth. Let's bow with me in a word of prayer. Lord, we are so thankful that You sent us Jesus. Lord, we pray that as we give back to You, Lord, out of joyful hearts because of the great life that You have given to us in Christ. Lord, we pray for this church. We pray that You would continue to build it up, that You would continue to make much of Yourself, that You would continue to rescue souls for Your glory. Lord, we think of the mission stream team from our church that is now in Haiti. Lord, we pray that You would use them mightily this next week, Lord, for Your kingdom work in the country of Haiti. We pray that You would use them to proclaim the gospel both in word and deed. We ask that You would protect them, keep them safe, keep them healthy. Lord, that they may return here to report of the good work that You have done through them. God, we thank You for the opportunity to give back. Lord, may You continue to give us opportunities to make much of You, not only in the way that we worship here on Sunday mornings, but in how we live our lives in serving this community. We pray this in Your name. Amen. Thank you, Alice. And as the children are dismissed to Children's Church, children just know that Children's Church will be in the new Children's Church room down here this morning. It won't be up in the sanctuary, so just make sure that you look for your teachers as you head out. So children, you may stand up and be dismissed. It's going to be in the children's wing, so have fun finding it. If we see them running around in the back, we'll know why later. Well, I've been enjoying preparing for this message, and just it's been an enjoyment to go through this series on the holiness of God, and we've been talking a lot over the last couple weeks of just practical ways that we can pursue holiness. And if you remember from our first week that we started off this series, we spent some time talking about the holiness of God and how we are living in awe of the holiness of God and how awestruck we can be that He is so far beyond us and so set apart, and that is the standard in which we were to pursue. And Pastor Talley spent a couple weeks talking about the dangers of the two extremes of legalism and license in our pursuit of holiness. And Pastor Woolgie just finished the past couple weeks talking about being a consumer versus being a contributor. And what a great challenge, and really just began to broaden my eyes to having a biblical perspective on how to pursue the holiness of God. Perspective makes a pretty big difference, doesn't it? This last week, my wife and I took our son Miles to his 2-year checkup. And at his 2-year checkup, he got his final vaccination shot for hepatitis. And the nurse came in to administer the shot, and she asked me if I would hold him down on the table and hold his arms and hands down so that he wouldn't flinch or wouldn't see the needle and freak out. And the poor little guy had no idea what was coming. And, you know, the other shots that he had, he's so young enough, he doesn't remember. I hope he doesn't remember this one. But sure enough, as you expect, when you prick him, you know, he just started screaming. But, you know, he saw the needle and didn't think anything of it. And so he cried in my arms for a little bit. But as I was holding him, some traumatic experiences from my own childhood started to flood my mind. Seems like every time I preach to you guys, you learn a little bit about all the terrible things that happened to me when I was a kid, or that I did. But when I was a boy, I was deathly afraid of needles. Anybody in here can say, I don't like needles. If I see them, get them away from me. I just didn't like them. And I remember there was, as a boy, I was probably 5 or 6 years old. We were playing at the McDonald's playgrounds, and back then they were made of metal. They weren't these nice plastic protected things, you know. They were just sturdy metal out in the rain. You could climb up in them. I mean, it was awesome. You could, you know, survive a war in those things. And I was running up the stairs, and I tripped, and my chin landed on one of the metal steps and split my chin open, and I needed stitches. So took me to the emergency room, and I'm like, okay, you know, they're going to put a Band-Aid on it. That will be great. And the doctor tells my parents, nope, oh, that's going to be stitches. I don't recall how many stitches it took. All I heard was the word stitches, and I went nuts. The doctors came in and tried to, you know, stitch my chin up, and I wouldn't let them get anywhere near it. So they had to bring in a couple more, try to hold me down. And then realized that they were fighting against the strongest little boy that I ever met, and they couldn't hold me down. And I didn't recognize that they needed to do this for my benefit. I didn't know that this needle was going to actually protect me from bleeding out or from getting an infection that would be a long-term health issue. So what ended up happening is they ended up putting me in a straitjacket, strapping me down to a table. And all I remember was this blue straitjacket, and I'm screaming and squirming. And my wife told me not to tell you guys all the awful things I said to the doctors. But I threatened them in multiple ways, and as a 5-year-old. And it continued on in my adolescence, even. My mom, I remember we were going to just a normal checkup, and she knew that they were going to pick my finger for blood. And so she was trying to bribe me to man up and just let them prick your finger. And so I think she had offered me maybe like a half a dozen donuts if I behaved like a man. Sure enough, I saw the needle, and I freaked out. And they had to come in and try to hold me down again. And it took multiple nurses. And I'm screaming and squirming. And it was a battle. But I didn't realize that these shots were for my benefit. They were to protect me long term. They were, whether it was a vaccination or for stitches. They could keep me from sickness or even potential death had I get some severe disease, just like my son Miles with his vaccination. I needed that shot. I needed that needle to do its work, but I couldn't overcome my immediate fear of going through that pain. I couldn't see beyond the moment that I was currently in. Many of us are like this spiritually. We don't think beyond the temporal things. We don't step back and view our life beyond the here and the now. If we could only realize that our entire life here on this earth is but a glimmer in the span of eternity, we would live differently. We are dead in our sin and in need of an injection of God's holiness, and yet many of us aim to avoid the pain, work, and discomfort that are required to pursue God's holiness. Today we're going to talk about how our future hope of holiness will lead us to an eternal perspective that must change who we are today. We can hope that there will be a day that we will no longer be on this earth, that we will no longer be in these bodies, that we will be with God in glory, that we will see the full glory and the holiness of God. And we get to look forward to that. We get to look forward to being in His presence, that God is going to be all we would ever want or desire. We get to look forward to that. But that changes how we live now. And so I like to call this an eternal perspective. Do we have an eternal perspective? Do we have a perspective that sees beyond the here and the now in our pursuit of holiness? Because it's drastically going to change who we are today. And so we're going to talk about essentials to maintain an eternal perspective. And so the first essential that we're going to talk about, an eternal perspective is based upon our eternal salvation. If you don't realize that this life is just the beginning of eternity, and you think, I'm going to die and that's it, there's nothing else, then you have no need to think beyond the here and now. Many people in the world live that way. Get what you can now, because if you don't, you're dead, and that's it. Enjoy everything you can before your life is over. But if we see that there is a God who expects us to be holy as He is holy, then we see that we have great need for a Savior. And we see that we need salvation. We need Jesus. And with that, we recognize, I don't want to spend eternity experiencing God's wrath apart from God's holiness. That's not the life I want for eternity. And we see that we need salvation. And we talked about this concept of positional holiness during our first Sunday. And we've kind of carried on that reference throughout the series. And we find that our positional holiness is found in Jesus. Turn with me now to the book of 1 Peter. We've been going through the first chapter of 1 Peter and jumping around. Pastor Ruggie was there last week. But we're going to focus in on the first part of it. Read with me 1 Peter verses 3 through 5. Peter writes, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to His great mercy, He has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." He has caused us to be born again to a living hope. Guess what? You have a new life. You're no longer condemned to death. You're no longer dead in your trespasses. You're born again to a living hope. You no longer have to say, I'm doomed to an eternity in hell. No, we get to say, I have the hope to experience the glory of God, the holiness of God. And that's pretty awesome, because this positional holiness changes a lot of things. It changes how God sees us. Because right now, in our sinful state, our depraved state, God sees us as sinners, right? He looks at our life record and He says, okay, here's all the commandments of mine that you've broken. Here's all the ways that you have been not holy, that you haven't been like God. And He judges you accordingly, justly so. But when you put your faith in Jesus Christ, a pretty amazing thing happens. You put your faith in Jesus Christ and His blood covers you. His sacrifice covers you. And so what happens? God no longer sees our life record, but He sees you through the blood of Jesus. And you know what Jesus did when He came to earth? It was so cool that He was fully God and fully man. He was able to do something that no one else could. He lived a perfect life. He fulfilled the law. He did what no man could do, and that was be fully obedient to God the Father, to never sin. He was born without a sin nature. And because of that, when He died, He was the perfect sacrifice. And so because He was fully God and fully man, His sacrifice is able to cover all of our sins. So when God sees us, guess whose life record He sees? He sees Jesus' life record. He doesn't see us. He doesn't say, okay, there's Chris, the rotten sinner, who threatened a doctor for trying to sew his chin up. That's not who He sees. He sees me as His son, Jesus. That's pretty awesome. Turn with me to Romans 5. The next thing we see is our positional holiness gives us access to God and to Jesus' full inheritance. Romans 5, 1 and 2 says, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have also obtained access by faith. That's awesome. We're enemies. We now have peace with God. We're justified by our faith, not by our works, because we try to serve God, we try to be perfect, and we fail. Faith in Jesus alone justifies us. That's mind-blowing. The other amazing thing, remember our study in Hebrews that wasn't so far beyond us? We talked about Jesus as our high priest, functioning for us, giving us immediate access to God the Father at any moment, any location, at any time, any place. You have access to God because of Jesus. That's amazing. That completely changes the game. Romans 8, 12 through 17. Flip a page or so over. Paul writes this, so then, brothers, we are debtors not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if you live by the Spirit, you put to death the deeds of the holy body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit Himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with Him in order that we may also be glorified with Him. That means that we get the full inheritance of Jesus. How awesome is that? We go from being enemies to not only perfect, able to have access to God, but even better than that, we're adopted sons to receive the full inheritance that Jesus would receive from the Father, an eternal inheritance, not one that we could squander and waste away, but one that will last for eternity. That is what our positional holiness does for us. Folks, this is amazing. If you don't know Jesus Christ, and you are living in a life that is full of fear because you don't know what's going to happen next. You can't solve life on your own. You can't fix your own problems. You can't earn your way to God. We need Jesus. And with a relationship with Jesus, when we truly understand all that He is to us, that changes everything for us. It changes how we think, how we absorb the world, how we live. And we're going to learn how we respond to various trials. The truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ empowers us to know what love is. It empowers us to even pursue God, to pursue holiness. Because apart from Jesus, I wouldn't even know what holiness is. I wouldn't even know how to pursue it. It's freeing. If I had to work for my justification, I would always fall short. But because I'm already justified, man, that motivates my obedience. The love that Jesus has given us, if we truly see all that it is, it has to motivate us to change. Saving faith has to bring us to change. I don't know about you, but My life can be really busy at times. It's going to get even busier soon. And sometimes I forget the gospel. I wake up and my first thought isn't, Lord, thank you so much for saving me and giving me another opportunity to make much of you this morning. I get up, I'm like, all right, here's my to-do list. I need to get this. Or even if, you know, I wake up on the wrong side of the bed or I didn't sleep well and I'm short with my wife or I don't have the patience with my son that he needs, I forget the gospel and that it leads me to pursue holiness. I forget it. We need to preach the gospel to ourselves daily because the gospel puts us in perspective. It puts us realizing that, Lord, all I have is Christ. If it weren't for you, I wouldn't be able to do anything in this world. I wouldn't be able to love my wife. I wouldn't be able to lead my family. I wouldn't be able to come here and shepherd people here. I would be some proud, arrogant guy thinking I had it all together and my life would just end up a mess and I would end up in hell. I need to be reminded of the gospel because it changes how I live daily. That is why we do communion. And we're going to do communion right now as a body of believers today. We are called to do communion so that we don't forget the gospel. That we don't forget the perspective we need to have. That we are saved. And that leads us to great hope. That we are not only, our sin did not just die with Christ, but that we raised with him also. That we are heirs with him. That we are no longer slaves to our sin, but that we can live by the Spirit, free of sin and pursuing God. I'm going to ask the men to come forward now as we begin to prepare to take communion. And this is something that we do to remember what God has done for us. And we do this as a church, but I encourage you that you would make, not necessarily taking communion on your own, but that you would make a daily habit to remember the gospel, that you would wake in the morning or throughout the day, that you would stop and think, Jesus, you have given me life. You have enabled me to pursue you and to pursue holiness. I'm no longer dead in my trespasses. I want to read to you a little bit in Romans 5. We're going to read in verses 6 through 11. It says, for while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare to even die. But God shows his love for us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. That's pretty awesome. Since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son. Much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. To have a right relationship with God. That is awesome. And we rejoice in that. And we're going to take some time to do that as a body. And I'm going to ask if Don Hatch would pray for the cup.
Father, as we have sung earlier this morning, it's all because of Jesus I'm alive. It's all because the blood of Jesus Christ covers me and saves this dead man's life. Father, I was dead and lost in my transgressions and my sins. Lord, the blood of Christ, Lord, the body of Christ was given for me. And Lord, I pray as we take this communion this morning that we would, Lord, see it personally, Lord, that you did it for me. You did it for each of us. Lord, that we can have life, that we can have forgiveness, and Lord, that we can have hope of eternity and Lord, a life of personal holiness here as we walk on this earth. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Jesus commanded us to remember him in this manner, that we would not forget what he came to do, that he came here on a mission, that we would be redeemed, that we would be reconciled to the Father. And he went through great sacrifice, it was great cost to him, to bring us to God the Father. And he says to his disciples, on the night that he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you," for us. He was so purposeful in that. What a love. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's drink. In the same manner, he broke bread. That we remember the sacrifice that he made. And he took a beating that day for us. The beating that we deserved. Let's take time and remember him in that way. I'm going to ask Dana if you would pray for the bread.
Dear Lord, we do thank you that you exchanged the place that we deserved on that cross. We didn't deserve you taking our place on that cross, but we just thank you that you gave your body broken, that we might have forgiveness of sin through your shed blood. And we just pray and give thanks for this time.
Thank you.
pretty amazing that he had the first communion with his disciples, and they didn't really know what was about to happen. Most of them dispersed pretty quickly. They didn't realize the sacrifice that Jesus was about to make for them. They didn't fully comprehend it. I wonder if they would, I'm sure they took communion very differently after seeing Jesus, after he was resurrected. But we have that 20/20 perspective. We know that people who would turn their backs against him, that would flee from him, that he would still chase after us, that he would still choose to love us, even though we would walk away from him. That's pretty amazing. That gives us great reason to celebrate. Let us remember that he chose us first. And we love him because he first loved us. Let's eat. Thank you, man. You may be seated. This remembrance that we just partook in, this act of communion, the sacrament of communion, leads us to live differently. It has to change the way that we think, the way that we respond. And so the next essential is that an internal perspective changes the way that we respond to life and trials. You remember that last week, what Pastor Woogie said? He said, life is hard. Some of us can really echo that. I'm very thankful that I haven't suffered extreme loss, but there are those of you who have. You've gone through some pretty amazing trials. And the fact that you're here today still praising God is a great thing. But life is hard. This world is broken down. Watch the news. It's heartbreaking. Just experience the division in this nation now. It's unbelievable the amount of hatred that people have for one another. And yet we live right next door to each other. To follow Jesus is not going to be easy. To pursue holiness, in fact, is going to be difficult. God promises us that. Turn with me to Matthew 24:9. Jesus says, "Then they will deliver you up to tribulation and put you to death, and you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake." He promises hardship. He promises, if you follow me, you're going to be persecuted. People will hate you because you follow Jesus, because you pursue to be holy as God is holy. Turn with me to John 15:20. Jesus says, "Remember the word I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you." People in the world are being persecuted because they follow Jesus. They are being sought out and destroyed because they follow Jesus. Turn with me now to 2 Timothy 3:12. This one was, you just read this and you're like, okay, life is going to be tough. It reads, "Indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted." Life following Jesus is not going to be easy, folks. We have to prepare our minds for that. This eternal perspective is so important. If we aren't ready for it, we're going to be taken off guard. Think about boxing. If somebody were to come up and I'm talking and I'm just haphazardly not thinking about something, and a guy comes over me and just decks me right in the face, what's probably going to happen? He's going to probably knock me right on my keister, right? But if I was a boxer and I'm in a stance, if I'm ready for those hits, I'm ready to take those hits. I know it's going to be tough. I can handle the hits a little bit better. I'm not going to fall on my feet. Spiritually, folks, we need to have that mindset. We need to know that following Jesus is not going to be easy. We are going to need to recall what we just celebrated so that we don't get hit haphazardly. We need that eternal perspective that, God, you've saved me, and I'm going to have to endure hardship. So the next thing is that the believer with an eternal perspective acknowledges that our faith will be tested to our benefit. We need to be tested because it's going to help us grow. It's going to help us recognize how much greater is the love of God. How much greater is his glory. Turn with me to 1 Peter 6 through 7. He writes this, "In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ." Remember that song that Pastor Woogie asked us to sing? Refiner's fire. Purify my heart. If you pray those prayers, be ready. He's going to mold you, and it's going to be painful. I remember, I joke around haphazardly, but seriously, one of the foolish things, you know, I joke around saying it was the dumbest thing I ever did was asking God to give me humility, make me humble. I will never pray that again, I promise. He just broke me. Just took everything that I thought my identity was in and just ripped it away. You pray for patience. Guess what God's going to do? He's going to put all kinds of things in your life that frustrate you, so you have plenty of opportunities to learn to be patient. If we pray this, God, refine me, change me, make me more holy, be ready. It's going to be difficult. You're going to go through trials. But if we don't lose focus on that eternal perspective that we've already been saved, Jesus has already won the war, we can find our strength in him, then we can be ready. We can be in that stance, ready for that spiritual battle. Turn with me now to Romans 5 again. And the next point I have is that the believer with an eternal perspective understands that our trials produce a character that will lead us to hope both now and eternally. The believer with an eternal perspective understands that our trials produce a character that will lead us to hope both now and eternally. Romans 5, 3 through 5 says this, "More than that, we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance. And endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us." When you think about endurance, what do you think about? Any runners in this room? I know there's a couple in the class back there. And if you want to run a marathon, what do you have to do? You have to train really, really hard so that your body can break down, and that you can develop that endurance so that you can handle longer and longer and longer amounts of stress on your body, that your muscles will get stronger to handle that activity. And so Paul compares this idea, endurance, to our spiritual walk. Sufferings produce endurance. Think about your life for a second. The trials that God has allowed you to go through, he's brought you through them. You're alive. May not be the results you want, but he's brought you through them. If you were to go through that same trial now, having already gone through it, would you be able to say, "Yes, Lord, I know you're going to bring me through this next one. I've been through this one already." If we look at God's track record, it's pretty good, isn't it? He hasn't let us down yet. And if we look at that and we say, okay, he's going to put me through stuff so that I can continually take away all the other things that I depend on and learn to depend on him, that I can see what is eternally valuable, so that I can develop that endurance. Now, what does that endurance lead us to? That endurance produces character. And character says, yep, here comes another trial. I'm not going to look at this as something, oh, I'm going to have to go through this. Oh, man, I'm going to get beat up, and I'm going to suffer, and I'm going to be just destroyed. No, character says another trial is another opportunity for God to be glorified. It's another opportunity for God to prove himself, to say, I'm greater than this trial. I'm stronger than what you're facing. And if it defeats you, guess what? You're dead. Holiness. Full glory. Pastor Tally jokes about that all the time. Yesterday we were moving together, and he said, no, I'm hoping that I never have to move again. Lord, I just give me glory before I have to move again. And he was saying that sarcastically. I'm sure Melody doesn't feel the same way. But he was just saying, oh, I understand what a great perspective that his glory is better than any trial that we'll face. But if we go through that trial, it's for our benefit. That's what character is. And that's derived from an eternal perspective. Seeing beyond the here and the now and the pain and the hardship that we're currently facing. And character leads to what? Hope. Hope of future holiness. Hope that we're not going to continue to have to be defeated by the same battle, the same sins that we face. We continue to make the same mistakes over and over again and saying, Lord, when is this going to end? That we're not going to be faced with all the brokenness that we experience in this world, the loss that we experience in this world. That is the hope. And character directs us to that. So when we're going through these trials, when we're going through this pursuit of holiness, and it gets tough, people, stop and say, God, I know you're going to get me through it one way or the other. And I know that there will be a day when this is all going to be over. And I'm going to be rejoicing because I'm going to be in the presence of a holy God. That's pretty awesome. That's pretty awesome. An eternal perspective does that for us. And one of the last things that we're gonna talk a little bit about what an eternal perspective does in regards to suffering is that a believer with an eternal perspective rejoices because our trials will never compare to the holiness and glory that awaits us. Turn with me now to Romans 8:18. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. It doesn't compare. Oh, it's worth it. If I have to go through these trials so that you can be made much of, Lord, so that other people can see what you're doing in my life so that they may know you, praise God. Because guess what? This trial doesn't matter because eventually I'm going to be in glory. And that blows this trial out of the water. It's worth it. Remember when I was going through those temper tantrums when I faced those needles. If I said, you know what? I'm not going to face this trial. I'm not going to go through it because I don't want the needle to sew up my chin. I'd be here with this, you know, infected chin. Maybe they have to chop off part of my face. Who knows what? I would have had to gone through something awful. Or if I didn't get my shots and my proper vaccines, and I've been on all kinds of mission trips and I got some kind of disease, and then I died. What good is that? I didn't understand that this trial doesn't compare to what the benefit is. And that is future glory. And these trials, the text that we've looked at, there's been this thing that keeps popping out at me as I was studying and preparing. And it's so countercultural to how we respond, especially here in America. Read with me in Romans 5, 2 through 3. Through him we have also obtained access by faith into his grace in which we stand. We rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Well, that makes sense. I'm going to rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. That makes a ton of sense. This next part doesn't. This next part says, more than that, we rejoice in our sufferings. If I came over and said, hey, I'm going to rip your toenail out, you're not going to rejoice through that, right? It's going to be painful and miserable. This perspective is, I'm going to rejoice in my sufferings because I know that God is doing something through it. That I know that it is breaking down all the things that I rely on so that I rely on God. I see that it's taking away everything that I can focus on so that I'm broken, that all I have left is to look to God. Folks, to be broken is to be healed. If we aren't broken, if we don't recognize that we have nothing else in life other than Christ, we're never going to look to Him. An internal perspective says we rejoice in our sufferings. We look at it as an opportunity for God to work, for God to be made much of. And that's so countercultural. People aren't walking around saying, I can't wait till the next trial that God's going to give me. We never hear that. Turn with me to Acts 5:41. This perspective just blew my mind away. Then they left the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer dishonor for the name. So they'd just been persecuted, made fun of, mocked because of their faith in Jesus. And they walked away rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer. What a perspective. What did they see that we didn't? What was their focus on? I can tell you. Eternal holiness. Through Jesus. When you're going through a trial, when you're facing life in general, is that your view? God, thank you for this. Thank you for counting me worthy that you would throw this in my life, that I would have to go through this so that you could do something, so that you could show me, that you could show others, that you could be glorified. I'll be honest, I don't respond that way. It's tough. I needed this message. Do we count our sufferings as joy, as an honor, that we would be counted worthy to suffer for the name of God? What a perspective. And finally, we'll turn back to 1 Peter, and we'll conclude there, which is fitting. This pursuit of holiness, it will be tough, folks. But an eternal perspective sees that salvation and suffering must lead to worship. 1 Peter 1:8 and 9 says this, though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Worship. Responding in worship for our salvation. That's easy. God, you saved me. Worshiping through trials, that's more challenging. But that's what it should lead us to. It should lead us to worship saying, God, I'm so thankful that you're here with me going through this. I can't imagine going through these trials and not having an eternal hope. Those trials would defeat me. The challenges that we face in life. It's so amazing that we have Christ. For those who don't have Christ, what do they have? No hope. It's the end. Life hasn't dealt them a fair set of cards. That's their perspective. Better off if I just die and it be over with. That's not the perspective that we have. Our perspective is worship. God, we can praise you because you have already won the war. We can praise you because you left your spirit here to help us live by the spirit, not of the flesh, to help us to pursue holiness now. This whole theme of holiness that lives that we've been thinking about is because as a pastoral staff, we want us to be actively pursuing it. It's a war. It takes effort. It takes steps and progress. It doesn't happen overnight all the time. But if we can continue to come back to this eternal perspective, this eternal hope, it makes a whole difference in how we pursue holiness, how we pursue to avoid license or legalism, how we avoid to be a consumer and we look to be a contributor. This eternal perspective motivates all of that. This eternal perspective is the thing that even gives us the ability to pursue holiness. Let's not forget that. Let's respond in worship. And as the worship team comes up now, as we begin to close, I ask that you would bow your heads with me and close your eyes. And as we close in prayer, I'd like to read in Romans 8, verses 31 through 39. And I pray that the truth of God's word would be an encouragement to you. There are those of you in this room who are facing trials now. You're going through them. There are those of you who your life is faced with daily trials. There are those of you who haven't had many trials in your life, but they're coming your way. That there are those of you who have made it through trials, and you know this is true. Pray with me as I read, "What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charges against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life nor angels nor rulers nor things present nor things to come nor power, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord." Oh God, we pray that we would not forget this truth. Lord, help us to maintain an eternal perspective on holiness. Lord, that our hope of future holiness would motivate us to pursue holiness now. Lord, your Spirit has enabled us to live by the Spirit, not of the flesh. Lord, may we not forget our positional holiness, how we are free from sin, that we may respond to life and trials in rejoicing and in worship. I pray for these people in this room now, Lord, whether they are facing trials in the current or they are going to face trials. Lord, I pray that you would strengthen them. May we be a body that encourages one another in how we respond in trials and how we lift one another up through trials. Lord, that your holiness may be present in this body and how we live day to day. Jesus, thank you so much that we are not alone. It is so awesome that we know that we can come to you daily, openly, freely, anytime, for strength to face this world. Let us not forget your grace. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Let's stand and close. Lord, I confess how weak I find my best. Without you, I fall apart. Confess our need for him. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God.
more, for grace is found, is where you are, where you are.
Light of the world.
will sing, no other name, Jesus, Jesus.
Amen.
Before you go, we just wanted to remind you that there will be an offering for Deacon's Fund at the door as you exit. I encourage those of you, if you're not in a small group, get in one. Because this is we're sharing life together, and we're going through trials. We need to encourage one another. So we're a church about being a builded community of worshipers. Share life with one another. Get connected to a small group. Have a great week.